All right, good morning. Welcome to Adams Square. We're going to start today with hymn number 268, He Lives, 268. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He Amen. Great singing. 478, please. Hymn 478. It is well with my soul. 478. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed His own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. My my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sighed, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
All right, last hymn for this morning is 495. Count Your Blessings, 495.
When upon life's billows you are tempted, tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Amen. Let us pray. It's an amazing thing, Father, to see this morning. I feel like maybe about half the people that were here last week in terms of number are here this week, but listen to how much louder and fuller the voices are, Lord. It just shows you that it's not about numbers, it's about the fullness of our belief, about the strength of our convictions, and about our fearlessness in expressing that for all to hear. So let us continue to sing, whether in our hearts or aloud, that only your ears might receive the glory that we proclaim. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, good morning, church. Good to see everybody today. Good morning. In our bulletins this morning, we see that teen night begins tonight at 6 p.m. So if there's any teens in here, teen night starting tonight, teens will gather at the church from 6 to 9 p.m. for a time of games, food and devotion. It's a place to be if you're a teenager, so keep that in mind starting tonight. And then as always, we have bus ministry. Please let me know if you know an adult or children that need a ride to church. We do that every Sunday, every Wednesday night as well. And then women's discipleship class that resumed this past Wednesday, and men's discipleship class, women's is at 6, just before church on Wednesday night. And then the men's, taught by Pastor Casey, is 8 p.m., right after church on Wednesday night. And then we have nursery provided, just located over in the fellowship hall if anybody needs that service today. And then, as always, we have Joe and the ladies. They have, on the first Sunday of the month, food and fellowship. And we got some light refreshments over there in the fellowship hall. So please feel free right after church to join us. Light refreshments and some drinks this morning. And then at this time, we're going to take up our Sunday morning offering. If I could have a couple of gentlemen to help out with that, please. Caleb, why don't you go ahead and pray for us?
All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone coming out this morning. I pray that we can have a great rest of our day. Pray that the service can go well. And I pray that we can get a bunch of teens to come out tonight for teen night. And thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Other announcements. In the back, we're going to have Vacation Bible School registration. I think we'll have somebody back there. It's a digital sign up. You can sign up online and then you are put right into that program. But next week, we're going to have a Vacation Bible School meeting right after church on Sunday. So if you are interested in Vacation Bible School, helping out, supplying the supplies, being a teacher, being an assistant, being anywhere involved in that, we'd really like that. Vacation Bible School is one of the biggest events that we have all year. We really pour into our kids, and we love seeing the results of that this year. An amazing Australian theme, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made by God. With all the things that's going around in society today, it's good to know where we actually came from, right? And so I'm thankful, Brother Tyron. I'm thankful for your Sunday school class going on right now, talking about evolution. Every time I come in and I get a couple of minutes of it, I'm learning something new that I learned wrong when I was in the fake news, I guess, education system before fake news was a fake news thing. You know, but I was in science class, and I remember this as clear as day. I was in eighth grade, and I remember my teacher. She said, I want you guys to take out this piece of paper. So we took out this piece of paper, and on the piece of paper, it had a bunch of little pictures on it. And then you cut the pictures out, and then you stapled it together, and then like a little fan picture book, you fan it open. And she said, "This is Pangea." And if you ever heard the word Pangea, Pangea is a simply word to say this is really a lie. But what it was is they had all the planets, I mean, all the continents, they were spread out all over the world, and then they said, this is Pangaea, and you just folded back and forth, and all the continents came together. And I just scratched my head as, you know, in eighth grade, looking at that, thinking, something doesn't look right here. This doesn't look good. Now, I didn't know Jesus back then, but I know that my logic kicked in and said, this did not happen. This didn't happen. And so I'm thankful for the little things that you're doing in that class are teaching things. You're not only teaching what does the Bible say, but I'm thankful that you're teaching what does the world say, and here's how you counter it with what the Word of God says. And we need to hear that. And so Vacation Bible School is really going to tie in this year to having a desire to teach the next generation, to teach your children how beautiful and how wonderful and how amazing they are in God's image and how God made them. So next Sunday, we'll have a Vacation Bible School meeting. And if you know anything about Vacation Bible School, from now until basically the end of June, it's going to be crazy around here. Decorations are going to be going up. You're going to see a lot of just crazy things going on, all for the cause of Jesus Christ, to see kids get saved. And then, Sean, can you mute that real quick? Can you mute the live stream, pause the live stream? Pause the live stream real quick. I'll be back, live stream, I'll be back. Begin taking up Wednesday night offerings. We have not taken up Wednesday night offering for a long time. We'll begin taking up our Wednesday night offerings again starting this Wednesday. If you put something in the offering plate and it goes to tithe or it goes to missions, it'll go towards that. But pretty much everything we bring in on the Wednesday night offering is going to be going to building a playground out back for our school. Right now we have some pretty generic stuff. But we want to enhance that and create that. We want to get rid of all that pea stone, and we want to put a pretty substantial playground system out there. I'm pricing them out. The prices are between, the starting price is about $15,000 for the commercial stuff, going all the way up to $25,000, $35,000. And that includes the rubber mat that you put down so when kids fall, they don't get hurt. And doing other drainage systems that we're going to need to do in order to for that to happen. And so Wednesday nights will be taken up the offering. Money has already come in for the offering for the playground. I think several thousand came in at the beginning of the year. Another 400 or 500 came in from buying all the hooded sweatshirts that we have. Incidentally, we have hoodies. We have any hoodies right now, but we have some hoodies. They have Freedom Christian Academy on the front chest, and on the back it has the Freedom Christian Academy Sentinel logo. I believe they're $45 a piece. Is that what they are? $45 for adults and $35 for kids. $35 for kids, $45 for adults. So if you'd like to get that one and support Freedom and Christian Academy, that'd be great. We'd really appreciate it. And then next month, we also have Vacation Bible School. We have one of our missionaries. If many of you know that back in 2020, I went to the Philippines and I met probably one of the most on-fire missionaries I think I've ever met in my entire life. He'll be here next month, spending a week with us. He'll be preaching on, probably on a Sunday, but he'll be preaching Vacation Bible School. And I really want to do something special for him, sending him back right now. He's building a new church building. He's currently pastoring 5 or 6 churches, I think maybe 7 churches by now, and he is currently building a new church building, and so we want to get behind him and help support the next building. Many of you know that when we were fighting the governor in 2020, as we were fighting the governor simultaneously, we were sending money to the Philippines to literally build a church from scratch, buy the land, build the church, and many, many have gotten saved and baptized, and so we're excited about that. God is doing a good thing. Amen. And then, so we have, we also have, is that it? Rach, is that it? VBS? What's that? Yes, Embrace Life. Embrace Life meeting is on Mondays. It's a support group for single moms or stressed out moms of young children. Let's face it, mothering is not for the faint of heart, and we can become a little battle-weary women. Embrace Life is a judgment-free environment where women can share their experience with one another while gaining biblical perspectives. We welcome single moms or moms of littles to join us each Monday night from 5 to 7. There is no cost, child care provided, and there will be light refreshments. So that's Embrace Life's on Monday night. And we're hoping one of these days we're going to hear a mom who has a good testimony about coming here and what has happened. Again, we're just in the starting phases of it with our church, with our ministry, and we're excited to see what's going on. And so I think that's it for announcements. Let's turn to Colossians chapter number 3. Last week we talked about Proverbs 31, what a Proverbs 31 wife is, what a Proverbs 31 woman is, what a Proverbs 31 mom is, and I got a lot of positive feedback, I got some okay feedback, and I got maybe a little bit of negative feedback, and I'm thankful for all the feedback because it kind of gives me a temperature check on where things are and how people are responding, and I felt like I didn't have enough time last week to just end it where I wanted to end it, so we're going to continue on, not necessarily with just the moms, but I think in the day and age in which we live in, people come to know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, and so you have a dad who comes to know Christ as a Savior, and statistically, whenever the father comes to know Christ as a Savior, statistically, the mother will come to know Christ, and the children will soon follow, because the father's taking the lead in things, and then conversely, when the mother comes to know Christ as their Savior, sometimes the father comes to know Christ, but more often the kids do. But what's really interesting is when the kids come to know Christ as their Savior, occasionally mom and dad come to know Christ is their Savior. So it's a biblical pattern. If we come to know Christ as our Savior, we should want to tell our spouse, we should want to tell our children, we should want to tell our family about the good news of Jesus Christ. And so being that said, there's a lot of people who say, you know, I'm a Christian, amen. I'm looking at probably a lot of Christians here this morning. I don't think there's probably maybe a few that might not be Christians here. So if you're a Christian and you live in a home, you have probably said to yourself, I have a Christian home because I'm a Christian. Well, I don't necessarily think that's the case. And I think the Bible has something more to say besides that. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you have a Christian home. And so how do we enforce and how do we resurrect a Christian home? Well, it's very simple. Sometimes people build buildings with substandard materials. How many of you remember the Florida high-rise that just collapsed a couple of months ago down in Florida, right on the beach, and several people, many people lost their lives, and the contractors came out and said, it's this person's fault, it's this person's fault, this person's fault, and this person's fault, and it came out to be, I think as the story goes, it came out to be that as they were creating the building, they weren't using the right kind of concrete, and the developers were paying off the building inspectors to look the other way, and therefore they got away with using substandard materials. And so if you know and I know, if we use substandard materials, there's oftentimes that we're going to see a catastrophic failure. One of the things that we get frustrated here in America is it takes so long to build something. It takes so long to get something. If we bought this building next door, and we bought CVS, and we bought this building and that building and that building and that building, and then we tore them all down, And we wanted to build a new school, because that would be a good idea for Freedom Christian Academy to have a new school, the new gymnasium, amen? Okay, so we would need about $25 million to do that, amen? All right, so pass the plates again. We would need about $25 million to do that. But you know the thing is, it would take us about, 18 months to 2 years for the planning to go through, for the engineer department to go through, for the building inspection to go through, for the just everything to go through. It would take 18 to 24 months because you have to get this permit and that permit, this permit, that permit. And sometimes we hear in America, like, oh, that's so frustrating. It's so crazy. It's so, I just can't believe it can happen. But here's the other thing. You go to some place like the Philippines, if you have the money, you can build it. You don't need to worry about a permit. You just get it done. You have blueprints, okay, we're gonna build it. You could have a little five-year-old kid mixing cement, no problem, you can just do it, right? Now, what happens when the rain comes? What happens when the wind comes, and the storm comes? The buildings fall down. They fall down because they weren't built properly. They weren't built to code. They weren't built to spec. They weren't built with the proper understanding. That had a blueprint, but it wasn't built correctly. You understand? So when we look at things like here in America, it takes a long time to build, but when you build it according to spec and you build it according to what engineers have designed and you build it according to what people have gone over, you tend to have a structure that's going to last a long time. If you were to ever walk with me and go upstairs and look above this beautiful ceiling that we have, The woodworking is absolutely phenomenal. It's absolutely gorgeous. One of these days, we might rip down the ceiling in the fellowship hall and expose the old 135-year-old beams that are over there. These four walls over here in the fellowship hall, it's the original four walls of Adams Square Baptist Church from 125 years ago. So the woodworking is still there. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's absolutely beautiful. There's a little hole upstairs in the teen room that you used to be able to look through and see in there and walk. It's just absolutely gorgeous. And as you go there, you realize there was craftsmen, there was tradesmen who really took a lot of time to build what they built. And so if we're going to have a Christian home, and we need to understand that God wants us to have a Christian home, but before we have a Christian home, there's two other homes that we need to talk about before we get to the Christian home. And I think the most important one that we should talk about is, do you have a heavenly home? Do you have a heavenly home? Do you know for certain that when you die, Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? Do you know when you die, you're going to die and go to heaven? And if you're here today and say, yeah, because I have given my life to Jesus Christ, praise the Lord, you have a heavenly home. Isn't that a good thing? Amen. And we should it should never get old talking about a heavenly home. It should never get old talking about where we're going to be one day for all of eternity. I sent my wife a text message yesterday. I think some of you know the story, but when my dad was dying of cancer, he was supposed to get on a private jet and fly out to Zion, Illinois. Zion, Illinois was this renowned cancer treatment center where they tried experimental cancer treatments. My dad had a private plane getting ready to take him off on the tarmac, and we had it all set up. It took us about a week to get it, or about 4 or 5 days to get it all set up, and he was ready to go. And I opened my Bible and I said, Lord, I need you to show me that everything's going to be okay with my dad. I need you to show me that my dad's going to be okay. And I was reading through Psalms, and I got to Psalm 20 because that was what my daily Bible reading. And Psalm 20 said something along the lines like, you're going to find help, you're going to find refuge, you're going to find healing in the land of Zion. And so I came out and I told my girlfriend, she was my fiance, she's going to be my wife in a couple of hours. I said, listen, God just told me my dad's going to be okay in Zion. I'm so excited. He's going to make it. He's going to live. And she didn't say anything. She said, yes, good. You know, she was excited for me. But what I didn't know at the time is that Zion was another name for heaven. And I didn't know that. And so there's times in our walk in our lives that we think something means something. We think we're going to be okay. We think we've got things figured out. We think everything's okay. And God has a different plan. God has a different way for us to live and how he wants us to act. And so if we're going to build our lives, we've got to build our lives upon a biblical base and a biblical knowledge. I'm thankful that my dad made it to Zion. It wasn't Zion, Illinois. It was Zion in heaven. And I'm thankful for that. Aren't you thankful for that, that your loved ones have died and gone to heaven if they have trusted Christ their Savior? And so yesterday as I was reading Psalm 20, I came to that word Zion, and I came to it in my Bible, and I was just rejoicing that my dad had a heavenly home. I was rejoicing that my wife was the one who told me what Zion meant. I was rejoicing, and sometimes you go back and you just think how amazing, how blessed you really are. And you just really, you begin to reminisce at how good God really is. But number two, I want to talk to you about a different home. Number two, I want to talk about your church home. If you're a member here, what does it mean to be a member? It means there's several ways to become a member. Number one, you are saved in our church, and then you are therefore baptized in our church. Therefore, you become a member automatically. So if you trust Christ as your Savior, and then you get baptized over here, or if you've been baptized in this one recently because this one was getting worked on, then by default, you are automatically a member in our church. But let's say you've been saved and baptized somewhere else, and you come here and you say, Pastor Casey, I've been saved and baptized somewhere else, and I ask you some more questions, and I find out that we are of like faith, then what do? We bring you forward, we say we'd like to extend the right hand of fellowship, and you become a member. Therefore, you have a church home. So if some of you are here today, you say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved, and I know that I've been baptized, but I don't know if I'm a member yet, then that maybe should be something that you contemplate, you think about, say, you know what, I like what's going on here. I've been here a little while, been here a couple of weeks, couple of months, you know, a year or so. I like what's going on. I want to have a church home. Because if you have a heavenly home, God wants you to have a church home. And if you have a church home, God wants you to have a godly home. And so I want to talk to you this morning about how to have a godly home. Now, I got to be transparent with you. As I'm going through a lot of these points, I was extremely convicted, so convicted that this morning I went to my son and I said, Caleb, normally you're coming to me saying sorry. I have to go to you this morning and say sorry. I have to say something. Before I get up and I preach, I have to say sorry because I haven't been the perfect example of what a father should be. And we'll get to that later on in the message. And I said I had to make things right. In the last couple of days, I've been really, you know, mulling this over and talking to my wife and just reminiscing on how good and how amazing she's been, especially early part of our marriage when there was times I was clueless. There was times I was delusional. There was times I was under the influence. And by my wife's grace and godliness, she persevered and continued to push me along in the right direction. And so I had to go back and say sorry, say thank you. And so it's a difficult message to preach, but I think sometimes the best messages that we get to preach on and we get to talk about are the ones that we take to heart ourselves. Is that a true statement? And where I get that from is, do you remember the story with the woman at the well? Jesus met the woman at the well, and he said, fetch me some water or give me some water. And she said, if you knew who you're talking to, I wouldn't get you any water. And, you know, I'm not going to get you. I'm not supposed to talk to you. You're not supposed to talk to me. And then Jesus proceeded to tell her whole life. And remember, what did she do? She left her watering pot and she went back into the whole village and she told everybody that she just met the Messiah. Amen. And so when you have that conversion, when you have that conversation with God, God begins to do something in you. You don't have to have a pulpit to preach from. You can have a Facebook Live you can preach from. You can have a YouTube channel you preach from. You can have something you can preach and teach the gospel from. Now, I say preaching is supposed to be just for the men if they're called to be a pastor. But, you know, we do have ladies in here or who are watching who like to share the gospel. They like to give the gospel out. They like to teach the gospel. And it's good when they're teaching people. It's a blessing when they're teaching other ladies the truth, when they're defending the faith and talking about Jesus Christ. It's an amazing thing. But if we're going to have a Christian home, we have to have a Christian home that produces godliness. We have to have a Christian home that's the desire to fall in line with what the Bible actually says. And so this is not just what Pastor Casey says. This is not what somebody else says. But what does the Bible say? How can I have a Christian home? And the truth be told, God uses broken people. God uses broken people. If any of us were perfect, we would be in heaven right now with Jesus. So since none of us are here, none of us are heaven, we're all here, we all know that we're not perfect. And so we need to realize that God uses broken people. And you know, as I was reading the Bible last night, I came across a very familiar story of David and Bathsheba. He was on top of his house. He looked and he saw and he lusted. Then he told his men, go get Bathsheba and bring her to me. And then Bathsheba came and he laid down with her and she conceived the child. And it wasn't but, you know, a year later, the child is born and the prophet Nathan goes to King David and says, thou art the man. And David repents, loses the child. And then something that I've always overlooked, something I always overlooked, but when after the punishment, you'd say, the punishment of David and Bathsheba losing that child, after the punishment was over because of the sin, Bathsheba conceived again, with Solomon. Solomon, one of the wisest person ever existed in the Bible, because that's what we ask the Lord for. You ask the Lord for wisdom. And Solomon, the Bible says that God loved Solomon. I just think, you know, in the midst of our sin, in the midst of doing things wrong, in the midst of God judging us, in the midst of God chastising us, in the midst of God doing things that are painful to us, he never loses that love. He never loses that tenderness. He never loses that care. He never loses that desire to show you and I how much he really loves us. You know, the biggest problem that we face in a lot of our lives as a born-again believer is letting go what God has already forgiven. Letting go what God has already forgiven. You know, and how do we do this? The Bible tells us to cast down every wicked and evil imagination that exalted itself against God. You go to the Lord, you're like, Lord, I'm sorry I did X, Y, and Z. And God forgives you, right? And then like 30 minutes later, the next day, 3 weeks later, you didn't do it again, but all of a sudden the devil throws something in your mind and you're like, oh, I can't believe I did that. And then you start thinking about, man, I did that, I did this, I said that, I went here, went there. And God's like, listen, I've already forgiven you. And that's why he says, cast down those high imaginations. And so if we're going to have a godly home, if we're truly going to have a godly, strong Christian home, we have to desire it. Turn with me, if you would, to Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter number 3. Verse number 10. And have put on the new man, which is renewed in the knowledge after the image of him that created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved. Put on. So there's something God wants us to put on, right? So every single one of us put on clothes this morning before we came to church. Praise God. Amen? I'm praising God. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God. Well, what does that mean, elect of God? Well, let's break that down a little bit. If you have, yes, children, if you have, it's good, I like it. If you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you are elected. You are getting to go to heaven because of what God has already done for you. Now, this is a whole little diatribe that people like to go down on, and I don't have time to go down there. But God has preordained people to go to heaven and preordained people to go to hell. Now, does God know who's going to go to heaven? Yes. Does he know who's going to go to hell? No, he does. He knows all of that. But it's not up to us to say, well, this person's preordained to go to heaven, so I'm going to tell them about Jesus. Oh, but that person's never going to go to heaven, so I don't want to tell them about Jesus. That's not up to us. It's up to us to understand God has already, before the foundation of the earth, created a place for us to go if we obeyed him and created a place for us to go when we disobey or if someone disobeys. So we put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave, so do ye. Right? So right then and there, God wants us to put things in our lives. God wants us to do things in our lives. God wants all of these things to be a part of our lives for his honor, for his praise, and his glory. Look what it says in verse 14. Above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. Right? So you put on all the clothes, and then when you put on this one, put on above all, it's like putting on an overcoat or putting on a winter jacket going outside. What are you supposed to put on above all that? Love. So if you're going to have a Christian home, if you're going to have a godly home, if your home is going to be based upon biblical Christianity, look what you have to do. You've got to be holy. You have to have bowels of mercy. You have to, what is that, bowels of mercy? The Bible tells us in Psalm 23, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. That goodness and that mercy, that goodness is when God looked at the earth, he looked at man, he looked at woman, he looked at all that he created on day six. What did he say? He was very pleased, and it was very good, right? So God was pleased, and it was very good. So if something was very good, God wants that goodness, that perfectness, that perfectness to chase us all the days of our lives. But then he goes on to say that surely goodness and mercy, what is mercy? Mercy is that you have been forgiven. And so you got to understand that forgiveness is going to chase you the rest of your life. Forgiveness is going to chase you to let you understand how much you have been forgiven. And you ask anybody who's been forgiven a long period of time, how did you understand how much you were forgiven when you first believed? And most of the time they'll say no. Because the closer you get to the Lord, the more you have been forgiven of him, because the more he reveals to you that you just haven't seen before. It's like if I went into this closet, I'm pretty sure there's stuff I haven't put in here that's still in here. I'm pretty sure it's dusty. I'm pretty sure it stinks. I'm pretty sure there's a bunch of things. And maybe sometimes, like you, if we open the closet, all the stuff might fall out on us, right? Because sometimes we just put things away, we really don't deal with it. What does God do? He wants us to be chased with mercy and forgiveness all the days of our lives. So if we're going to be filled with those mercies, those mercies come from the inside, it's also going to be kindness and humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. Forbearing, being long-suffering, right? That's dealing with people's idiosyncrasies. Well, does the toilet paper go over or does it go under? Right? Do you brew the coffee strong? You just brew it regularly. You want iced coffee? You want cold coffee? You want $5? You want Dunkin' Donuts? Or do you want something imported? I mean, there's all these little idiosyncrasies that you forbear. Well, how many pillows should we have on the bed? 74 or 72? I mean, like, there's all these things that we do that we just forbear. Now, I'm making light of it, but you know there's things that if you're going to have a Christian home and you're not living by yourself, you know there's things that you do that really irritate other people. All the ladies like, amen. And ladies, sometimes there's things that you do that irritate your significant other. And all the smart men are like, not today, Pastor, not today. So what do? You're forbearing one another and forgiving. Forgiving. You ever realize that when we don't forgive, it continues to stoke a fire? The wrong kind of fire in our relationship, the wrong kind of fire in our home, the wrong kind of fire in our lives. I don't know about you, but I like to fight. Even when I'm wrong. Even when I know I'm wrong. Even when I know that I know that I know that I know that I'm wrong, I still like to fight. Doesn't make it right. So what do? Oh yeah, you humble yourself. Forbearing one another, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave, so also do ye. So do you forgive? That's what God wants. How do you forgive? Let's look at, 10 or 11 things we'll look at this morning. Number one, look at verse 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts. What does God want? God wants you to have peace. Peace. How do you have that peace? You have that peace when your home is not a battlefield. When your home is not a battleground. You have that peace when you say, you know what, I'm not fighting anymore. I want the words that I say to be like what, Rachel? What is the phrase we have in the house? A honeycomb? We want our words to be as sweet as honey. You know, until a couple years ago, I didn't know what honey tasted like. I thought honey tasted like honeycombs. Like literally honeycombs from Post Cereal, you pour it and put milk in and you eat honeycombs. That's what I thought honey tasted like. But you know, when you taste that honey from the honeycomb for the first time, it literally melts in your mouth and you're like, woohoo! This is good. Does it make you feel good when someone speaks nice to you and kind to you and loving? That's what we should do all the time. Speak peacefully. Speak peacefully. We want the battlefield to take on outside the home, not inside the home. Well, look what it says in Philippians. And we might go a little long today, and I don't think you're going to mind that. Everybody loves going a little long, don't you? Amen. I got the AC on, so we can go a little longer. Philippians chapter 4, verse number 5. Man, you ever laugh because you're thinking about saying something and then you don't say it because you think of all the repercussions if you say it, even though it's really funny? That's what I was thinking right now. Wisdom says no. Philippians chapter 4, verse number 5. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything and by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. the peace of God. What does God want you to have? He wants you to have the peace of God. Now, I know sometimes we have peace in God. We have peace in God because we know what God can do. But God wants you to have his peace. So how do you get the peace of God? You got to understand that he loves you. He cares for you. He's trying to constantly reprove you, rebuke you, exhort you with all longsuffering. He's trying to constantly show you who he is and what he's all about so that you can have that eternal peace, that peace that lasts all the time. Look at Psalm 119, Psalm 119, 165. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Do you have that peace? How do you get that peace? How do you get the peace of God? Look what it says, great peace have they which love thy law. You know what that means? It means that if you love the word of God, and I know all of us say, yes, Pastor, I love the word of God. If you love the word of God, you'll spend more time in the word of God today than you did yesterday. Well, you might because it's Sunday, and it might be the only time during the week you pick it up. But if you love the word of God a lot, then you're going to say, you know what? I want to know more of what it says. So when an infraction, when someone does something, when someone says something, you have the peace from God because it doesn't offend you because you love God. You know what that means? That means more often than not, when we are offended, when we're offended, when someone does something, says something, doesn't do something, doesn't say something, we get offended. More often than not, the reason why we're offended is because we're not in the Word of God and we're not loving it the way God wants us to love it. Anybody want to testify? Yeah. How come? Why is that? Because we're still in the flesh. We're not perfect. We want our way. We want our situation. We want our circumstance. We want it our way. And God's like, listen, you don't need to have it your way. Why don't you have it his way? We're going to spend all of eternity worshiping God the way he wants us to worship him, not the way necessarily that we want to worship him. So we should begin to cultivate an attitude right now and say, Lord, I love you, and I love you so much that I want to have your peace. Can you imagine the peace that Jesus had when he was praying in the garden saying, Lord, not my will, but thy will be done? Can you imagine the peace that he had? Why peace? Peace because he knew that he was going to be crucified. Peace because he knew he was going to have his beard plucked out and his hair, you know, crown of thorns slammed into his head. Peace because he knew he was accomplishing the Father's will. And perhaps we would have more peace in this world if we understood that we were accomplishing the Heavenly Father's will. Colossians, chapter number 3. Number 1, God wants to have peace. Number 2, God wants us to have thankfulness. Colossians chapter 3, verse number 15. And let the peace of God rule your hearts. Rule. What does that mean? It means it's the number one law. You got to have that peace. Rule in your hearts, to which also you are called in one body, and to be ye thankful. It is easy to be ungrateful. It is easy to gripe. It is easy to bicker. It is easy to murmur. That's easy to do. What about being thankful for what we have? What about being thankful for what we have? You see, it's easy to live in your home, it's easy to live in your world, it's easy to live in your bubble and get upset. You get upset with your neighbor, you get upset with somebody else, and then sometimes it's righteously, sometimes it's just because of whatever, but when is the last time that you just said, you know what, I'm not going to be ungrateful today, I'm just going to be thankful. I talk to you all the time about how much of a picky eater I am. We were traveling back from Denver. We stopped at this. My wife, whenever we travel, she loves to experience new places. And I'm like, no, I just want to go to the same place and eat the same thing because I know what I'm going to get, right? And so I was trying to think about my wife, and I was trying to be concerned. And she every time we go away, she loves to have these fish tacos, and she wants to try fish tacos where we go. And I'm like, oh, cool. So I found this place, fish taco place. I go to the fish taco place, and I order just a regular taco. Just a regular burrito. And all I want was the burrito, and all I want was the meat. Burrito and meat. Burrito and meat. And if you've ever been to a restaurant with me before and I order burger, bacon, and bun, I say it 3 times. What would you like? Burger, bacon, bun, plain. Burger, bacon, bun, plain. I say it 3 times. Burger, bacon, bun, plain. So all of a sudden, my food gets there. It's got the burrito. It's got the meat. It's got lettuce. It's got cheese. It's got green things. I mean, it's got all kinds of stuff in it. I took that knife and I cut it in half. This is good. Right? Thankful. You know, I was thinking as I was eating that. It's not that bad. Sometimes somebody else's mess up actually tastes pretty good. No, but it teaches you to be thankful. You think if God wanted me to have the way I wanted, I would have had it. I would have had it the way I wanted it. But sometimes we don't get the things the way we want because God wants to realize how thankful are you really. You ever expect to get something or to do something and it doesn't happen? Don't you know I want it my way? Well, sometimes God throws curveballs at us to prove just how unthankful we really are. Number three. Look what it says in verse 16. You want to have a happy home? Let there be peace in your home. You want to have a happy Christian home, strong Christian home, let there be thankfulness, thanksgiving, thankfulness in your home. Number three, you want to have a happy home? Look at verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. You want to have a happy Christian home? How much of Christ's word is in your heart on a daily basis? Well, it's not in my spouse. Okay. It's not in my kids. Okay. How much is in you? Well, I read my daily Bible app. That's good. That's good. Turn to me, if you would, to Proverbs chapter number 16. Proverbs chapter number 16. It's the great equalizer. If you think everything's good and everything is everybody else's fault, look at Proverbs 16, verse number 18. It's not my fault. I didn't do it. It's their fault. Whoever there is, maybe you live by yourself. It's still their fault. Proverbs 16, verse number 18. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. It's the other person's fault. No. It might be the other person's fault. But maybe pride is what's keeping you, or keeping your family, or keeping your marriage from being what it really should be. So what do we want to do? We want to invest in the Word of God. We want to immerse ourselves in the Word of God. We want to meditate and pray and think about and mull over the Word of God. I love that on Wednesday we had a men's Bible study on Wednesday after church, and we talked about how do you spend the time that you give to the Lord. You spend the first third, you know, reading. You spend the second third praying. You spend the third mulling over what you had just heard, and the thirds can be split up anyway. But if you got 15 minutes for God and that's what you budget him, spend 5 minutes in prayer, 5 minutes in reading, 5 minutes of meditating over what you read. Right, give the Lord something and just start with it and watch what God can do. It's a pretty amazing thing when the Word of God is doing something in your life. I've got a cousin who's doing a 20-year murder sentence down in Tennessee State Prison. Shortly after he got into prison, I led him to the Lord. And after he started, he would grow a little bit. Then he got involved in the gangs. And then he got out of the gangs. And he would grow a little bit. And then he got involved in the gangs again. They got transferred to a different prison. And finally, I just said to him, stop messing around with the gangs. Just fall in love with Jesus and go to church. And wouldn't you know, just a couple of weeks ago, I got a certificate in the mail that said, I was just baptized. I gave my life to Jesus Christ, and I was just baptized. You know, he spent 11 years playing games with God. 11 years playing games in the gang and playing this and playing that. And finally, over the last year and a half, 2 years, he really just got it. He got it, and he stopped playing games, and he started living for God the way the Lord wanted to live for him. Listen, if we're going to spend time serving God, worshiping God, we've got to put the Bible inside of us. It's got to be a part of our lives. It's got to be a part of something that changes our life. So you know what? I want the Word of God to be in me. Look what it says, verse 16. Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly. What does it mean? What does it mean to be rich? Now, every one of us in here has a different definition of being rich. Some of us being rich might have $1,000 in your bank account. That might be rich. Some of you it might be $10,000. Some of you it might be $100,000. Some of you it might be $1 million. Some of you might be 5 million, you tell me, and each one of us have a different definition of being rich. But the definition of let the word of God richly dwell in you, your definition might be different from somebody else. Your definition might be I'm in the Bible 5 minutes a day. But somebody else might be in the Bible for an hour a day and praying for an hour and meditating for an hour. That might be richly in them. But don't compare yourself to the other person. Compare yourself to, are you doing what God wants you to do? And if the word of God is richly dwelling you, you will read the Bible. You will be in the word. You will teach your wife, or your wife will teach you to read the Bible. You will teach your children. You say, I don't know where to start. Start in a New Testament. Work your way through the New Testament 2 or 3 times. That's a good way to start. Why? The Old Testament, it's difficult to go through sometimes. I'm not saying avoid it, but I'm saying if you're new to being in the Word of God, if you're new to the family devotions, if you're new to your prayer time, if you're new to understanding the Word of God, jump in the New Testament. Start with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Jump right there and read that through 2 or 3 times before you go back to the Old Testament, and things will start to be a whole lot more clear as you go through. But read the Bible. Read the Bible. Do what it says. Read the Bible. Do what it says. Look at number four, look at verse 16 and 17. Let the word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. Right? So what does it mean, teaching and admonishing? Admonishing is to counsel against the worldliness, or counsel against wrong. That's what it means to admonish. So if we're going to admonish, what does that mean? We're going to tell people, look, that's not what you should do. Don't go here. Don't do that. Just the other day, my daughter she sent me a text message, Dad, I would like to talk to this girl. And I said, no, you can't. She said, why? And I said, because the girl and her mom are crazy. She looked at me. I said, have I ever told you in 11 years that you couldn't talk to someone? She said, no. I said, don't talk to that girl and don't talk to her mom because they're crazy. Certifiably crazy, don't talk to them. And she just looked at me. So I'm warning you, if you talk to them, you're going to go down the wrong path. Then I brought her to Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But in his law, what does he do? He does meditate day and night. Right, right. Listen, I don't say about everybody, and this person's not here, nobody knows this person, but I'm saying there's certain times that you have to say no. There's certain times you say, that can't happen. I can't go there. I can't do that. I'm admonishing. I'm counseling against worldliness, or I'm counseling against wrong. I'm counseling against ungodly practices. Why? I want to admonish. But what does it mean to teach? Teach. What does it mean to teach? You know, teach them something. We all know we've taught our kids some bad habits. Yeah, I said when Cameron was born, I picked up the apple and I threw it as far away from my tree as she possibly could go. And now the joke is, it was on a hill and she rolled back down. What do you teach? What do you teach? Well, we're going to get to it. Look what it says. Look at the next thing. Verse 17. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. I mean, do you all have a song that you love to sing? I remember when Cameron and Caleb when we were first here pastoring, we were on our way to Twin City Christian School City in Lunenburg. Twin City Christian School City in Lunenburg, right, Caleb? And we were on our way there, and there was a song on the radio, God's not dead, he's surely alive, living on the inside, right? And then there's this one part where it gets really soft, really, really soft, and it gets really, really loud, and when it got to the really, really loud part, that's when I just cranked the radio, right? And you just start singing at the top of your lungs, we would have a good time. Are you singing in a constant songs and hymns and spiritual songs? It's constant. Because you know what? The world wants to take your joy away. The world wants to take the thought of Christ away from you. But look what it says in verse 17. Here's the one. So point number 5 is if we're going to have Christ-honoring music, then we have to have Christ-honoring TV, Christ-honoring computer time, Christ-honoring cell phone time, Christ-honoring music time. If we're not willing to watch it with our kids, perhaps we shouldn't watch it when they're not around. Ouch. Convicted. Verse 17, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Now, you probably heard it said this way, actions speak louder than words. Actions speak louder than words. You've heard that before, right? Well, guess what? That's a knockoff from what the Bible says. The Bible says, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, whatever you do in word or deed, whatever you do in word or deed, word, oh, we're not going to go there, we're not going to do that, we're not going to say this, we're not going to say that, we're not going to watch this, we're not going to watch that. Whatever you do in word, what are you doing in deed? See, the word is what you say, you're saying the words, but what are you doing? Now, I know right then and here, this is the great equalizer for every single one in here, we're hypocrites. You ever heard somebody say, I don't want to go to church because they're full of hypocrites? They're right. They're right. Because we hear the word, we see it, we know it, we say it. Or how about this? You know, do as I say, don't do as I do. Have you heard that growing up? Yeah. I used to grab my dad's cigarettes from him, snap them in half. Said, you break another one, I'm going to break your finger. I was like, yeah, you like that. When you grow up, don't do this. Well, why are you doing it? All these things happen. All these things happen. Look what it says in verse number 17. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. So we talked about thankfulness. We talked about living the way God wants us to live. But look what the next verse says. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as is fit for the Lord. Fit for the Lord? Uh-oh. So we talked about submission last week. What is submission? I think I think sometimes this is what scares people away from Baptist churches. In a lot of Baptist churches, it means the husband has the final authority, and he's the one that rules the house, and the woman and the children bow down to him, and he is the one that makes all the decision, and he's the one that's almighty, and he should be feared. I don't think that's what the Bible says. Hello? Now, I'm not preaching a feminist message, but what I am preaching is what the Bible says. That, yes, wives are to submit. But when you look at the word submit and you follow the etymology of where the word comes, it's serving. Yes, the husband is the head of the home, and it was established in Genesis because of the fall of man, and we understand that. But if the man gets up there pompous and says, well, this is what it's going to be, and I don't care what you think, that's a very difficult role for a wife. That's a very difficult role for children. But if the man is going to be a man of God and you're going to have a Christian home, he's going to say, what do you think? And he's going to ask input from the wife. And the wife is going to say, I don't think we should do this, or I don't think we should do that. I think we should do this. And the husband's going to have to calibrate everything and look at it and weigh it all out. And he might go with what his wife said. And he might go not with what his wife said. At the end of the day, the responsibility falls on the husband to make that decision. But it's not for the wives to rise up against their husband. It's not, on the converse, the husband to continue to push his wife down. But we are to what? Build each other up. To love each other. You know, I've counseled many men and women, and one of the things that we've heard in the last 10 years as me being a senior pastor and prior 7 years to that is I have seen husbands beat their wife up physically. And they can get over it and they come back home because he was drunk or he's high or he did something. He was in a fit of rage and he said, I'll never do it again. And I have seen it. I've seen changes. I've seen transformations, and I've seen marriages go from being broken and battered to alive and functioning. But on the contrary, I've also seen husbands and wives literally beat each other down with their words, and they never get over it. It's funny how a black and blue can go away in a week or two, but something that we said 12, 15, 25 years ago, 50 years ago, it almost never goes away. If we're going to have a godly Christian home, there comes a time in our lives that we've got to say to ourselves, I forgive. I forgive. I forgive. Forgiving doesn't take away the action. Forgiving doesn't take away the repercussions. Forgiving doesn't take away the consequence. I'm sure Magic Johnson's wife must have forgiven him for what he did to acquire AIDS. There's forgiveness. It doesn't get rid of the repercussions. It doesn't get rid of what happened. It doesn't get rid of the sexually transmitted disease that he got. Doesn't go away. So what do? Say, listen, if we're gonna look at the wives real quick, look what it says. It says, wives, what are we supposed to do? Submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. So that submission process is service. How can I help my husband do what he needs to do? How can I be a blessing to him? Listen, there's no wife in here that's perfect. And for any husband to say my wife is 100% perfect and will never make an error is a fool. But we can say that when God brings a man and a woman together, that God is the one who fits them in for happily matrimony. And God's design is for that family, that husband and the wife, to be happy and satisfied with each other. Do things happen? Do circumstances happen? They absolutely do. So does God give us a way out? Of course he does. Does God give us a way to reconcile? Of course he does. That's how amazing and wonderful our God is. But why does he do this? He does it. Why does he put it there? He puts it there because he wants us to know that for wives, it is for them to serve their husband, to serve their family, to serve their community, to have a role of servitude. Look what it says in Ephesians chapter number 5. Ephesians chapter number 5, verse number 22, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is unto the Lord. But go back to the verse prior to that. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. You see, it's not just the husband ruling with an iron thumb and an iron fist and saying, this is what it's going to be. But how about submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God? How about realizing, wives, your husband is made different than you? Husbands, how about realizing your wives was made more emotional than you may ever be? And what we need to do is spend time learning our spouse, learning one another. Why? When you learn, there's peace. Crickets. Chirp, chirp, chirp. When you learn each other, there's peace. When you learn each other, there's thanksgiving. When you learn each other, the word of God is richly going to dwell in you. When you learn each other, you can teach them and they can teach you. When you really love them and when you're really trying to honor God with your home, there's going to be God-honoring music. When you really love them, you're going to have the love of Christ that richly dwells in you. When you really love them and want to have a God-honoring home, that you're going to be accountable to Jesus and you're going to do what Jesus wants you to do. Look what else it says, verse 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives. And see, that's where it doesn't end. It says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So in a couple, don't worry, ladies, we're going to get the husbands. But notice what it says, that the wives are supposed to submit to their husbands, but husbands are supposed to what? Love their wife and give himself for his wife like Christ gave himself for the church. Christ didn't beat the church up. Christ didn't give the church a black eye. Christ didn't beat the church down. Christ didn't make fun of the church. Christ didn't laugh at the church. In fact, if you want to know the number one reason why I walked away from Liberty, is because Christ told me not to fight the church. Christ said, that's my bride. A test of a true man is, can you walk away when you were slapped? Can you walk away when you've been punched? Can you walk away when you've been belittled and mocked and ridiculed? Can you walk away when the firestorm is going? Can you walk away? On a side note, sometimes I have no idea what God brings me to messages. I was up in the bell tower last night. I was praying, Lord, what do you want me to preach? What do you want me to preach? And God's like, I'm going to preach this. And I said, no, really, what do you want me to preach? He says, I want you to preach this. I said, well, I preached a little bit about that last week. He said, I want you to keep on going. In fact, I just want you to have the next couple of weeks, I want you to preach about it. I said, really? He says, yeah. He said, the church needs it. Church needs it. We don't need gimmicks and games and gazmos. We need God. And the world is doing so much it can to pull your attention away from God that you've got to push yourself back from the world and say, you know what? I want more God. I want more Jesus. I want more Holy Spirit. I want more godliness. Right? Wives, if you're sitting here today and you say, my husband's failing, pray more. Husbands, if you're sitting here today and saying, my wife's not like that wife last week, pray more. So I don't know what to pray. How about you spend more time praying about how grateful you are to have what you have as opposed to being praying about how bitter and angry you are at what you really have? Husbands, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. Husbands, when's the last time that you were crying out to the Lord, asking him to cleanse your wife through the Word of God? Ayo. That he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. What do we see? We see a lot of husbands who aren't loving themselves, therefore they're not going to love their wives. And what does it mean to love themselves? It's not talking about loving yourself in the dark when your wife's not around, husbands. I don't think I need to go down that road of analogy anymore, but I think it's very clear. God gave us a wife, and he has whosoever findeth a wife findeth a good thing. Remember that first time you saw your wife, you're like, oh, she's beautiful, she's gorgeous, she's all those things, and then you get married, and you're like, oh, she's still all of those things, and then the honeymoon's over, you're like, what happened? You were smitten with her love and with her looks and with her lust, and now you want to smite her. You've lost that loving feeling. You've lost that love. You've lost that lust. You know what happens when you lose the lust and you lose the love? You begin to look for someone else. And when you begin to look for something else, you begin to, like David did, begin to, instead of being at the forefront of the war, he was on top of his house and he was looking down. And what did he see? He saw beautiful Bathsheba. And a godly man, which David was, a godly man should have looked away after he saw the first look, but he didn't. So David's godliness turned to ungodliness. And he looked and he lusted and then he longed for. And then he lured her there and then he laid with her. And yet the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. Why? Because after he was broken, God forgave him. After he was broken, God forgave him. Didn't mean judgment went away, but God forgave him. We should be looking for the forgiveness of the Lord. Husbands, I want you to travel with me. Genesis chapter number 2, and we're going to look real quick. Maybe. Genesis chapter number 2. Some things that husbands need to do for their wives. Genesis chapter number 2, verse 23. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She should be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. So number one, husbands, what should you do? You should leave your mother and your father and you should be one flesh. If you should be one flesh and you should continue to be one flesh all the days of your marriage and all the days of your lives, just as you wouldn't cut off your fingers, so you shouldn't cut off your wife's opinion. Proverbs chapter number 5. Something else for us to do, husbands. Proverbs chapter number 5, verse number 18. Let thy fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of thy youth. So my wife is an old hag now. I shouldn't rejoice anymore. You're a fool. You're a fool to think she's old and I can't rejoice with her anymore. My wife was young and she was hip and she did this and she did that and she went here and she went there. And now she's a little bit older and she has a harder time going there, so I should just trade her in and get 220s or 225-year-olds. That's the joke. But notice this, it says, rejoice with the wife of thy youth. No matter how old your wife gets, she's always going to be younger than somebody else's wife. But here's the deal. If you're going to rejoice with the wife of thy youth, that constant rejoicing is, do you remember that joy when you first saw her? None of you men remember the joy when you first saw her. I'll try this side. Do you remember the joy when you first saw her? You remember how excited you got, how happy you got? Maybe you were saved, maybe you weren't. Then you finally got saved and you finally had the right kind of marriage. You're trying to develop that right kind of marriage. You should rejoice at everything you and your wife have gone through to get to where you are today. And you should rejoice at how beautiful she is. And you would rejoice at how beautiful she is, even though as things, as people age and women get older and things don't look the way they first did when you first saw them, you should still rejoice because that's your wife. And she needs you to rejoice at her. But here's the problem, here's the conundrum, here's the thing. It's hard for you to rejoice of the wife of thy youth when you're too busy looking at what the VHS says, when you look at what the DVD says, when you look at what the stream says, and it shows you what the perfect woman should really look like. Reality check, it's not reality. But you begin to look at the perfect woman, and all of a sudden your wife doesn't look like the perfect woman, and now you don't like your wife because she doesn't look like that, but your wife can't look like that because she's already had 3 or 4 kids. And she'll never look like that again. But now you're at this conundrum like, hey, I want her to look like it. Well, stop thinking about what she used to look like and start rejoicing at what she is now. Because her beauty of what she really looked like is not necessarily just on the outside, but it's also on the inside. And perhaps if we lifted up our wife more often, and we encouraged them more often, and we loved them more often, we told them how beautiful and wonderful, perhaps if we walked around and we slapped them on the butt like we used to when we were first married. Or you put your hand on their hip and caress them, or their shoulder, and you loved them and you gave them non-sexual love, perhaps it would be easier for them to show you what you're looking for. Rejoice in everything you've went through. Rejoice in the good time. Rejoice in the okay time. Rejoice in the bad time, because if you're still together, God brought you through it. And whatever didn't kill you is going to make you stronger. So you should rejoice. And if you're not married yet, or you've been married and you've had the unfortunate thing to get divorced, you're on the road for divorce, guess what? Rejoice that God still has a plan and still loves you and still cares for you. And if you're the husband, step up and be the husband God wants you to be. Look what it says in Ecclesiastes. 1 book over, Ecclesiastes 9. Ecclesiastes 9:9. Live joyfully with the wife whom thou lovest all the days of thy life, of thy vanity, which he hath given thee under the sun, and all the days of thy vanity. For that is the portion in this life, and in thy labor which thou takest under the sun. Rejoice in thy wife whom thou lovest all thy days of thy life. All your days. And that's what we should do. And if you're not married yet, you say, Lord, I want to love a woman all the days of my life. A woman, a woman, 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 woman. I want to love one woman all the days of my life. One, all the days. Lord, I'm saved. I'm in church. I got a church home. I got my own home. I'm trying to have a godly home. Lord, I want to have a woman in my life that I can love all days of my life. Lord, bring one there. And all the single men said, oh, single man, get ready, hit me with a guitar. Don't you want a woman? Pray for it. Lord, I need one. I want one, I desire one. Could you bring me one? Maybe she's already here. And all the single ladies are ducking under the pews. Husbands, it's our job to love our wives all the days of our lives and all the days of their lives. You know, the sickening thing is that sometimes we go through our life that we fall out of love. There's sometimes you go through our life, you say, I don't love her anymore. I don't want to be around her. I can't stand her. I despise her. I don't like anything about her. I can't believe she does this or that. When you were down, where was she? When you were down and out, where was she? Right there by your side, sometimes holding the pieces together. When you were doing foolish things, where was she? Holding down one job, two jobs, working overtime to provide for the family. But I can't stand her. Perhaps the things you can't stand about her are the things you can't stand about yourself. 1 Peter. Y'all with me this morning? We good? This afternoon, we good? 1 Peter chapter 3. Verse number 7, Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to the knowledge, giving honor unto thy wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Maybe, just maybe, you're not getting the answers to prayers because you're not honoring her. You're not loving her. You're not cherishing her like she's the weaker vessel. You're not running around the car to get the groceries, you're just letting her carry them in. You're not opening the door anymore because the thrill is gone. You know what always gets me going to a restaurant and having double doors? You're on a date, you got that first door, you got to open it, hold on right here. As the first door hits her in the face. Sorry, oh, I got this. It's not that she can't do it. It's not that she can't get on the roof and shingle the roof with you. It's not that she can't put her own gas in her own vehicle. It's not that she can't change her own oil. It's not that she can't do any of this. It's but you love her and you honor her. You don't want her to smell like gas. You don't want her to smell like oil. You want her to smell beautiful the way God designed her. So you cherish her. You honor her. I know some of you looking at me like, Pastor, well, what if I'm not going to get married? You don't know that. You don't know if God's going to wait until you're 87 to finally give you a husband. Not me. You don't know. I don't desire it. You might not. I got a friend of mine who's a pastor. He used to be a pastor down in Norwalk, Connecticut. His wife died about 7 years ago, took a mission trip, went down to Mexico, and he fell in love with this 65-year-old woman who had been a widow for 40 years. Her husband died when she was 25. 40 years she was a widow. He came down, took a mission trip, fell in love. They get married in their middle 60s. It's possible. Some of y'all are like, Pastor, what's the next point? Kids. Look what it says in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter number 6. Ephesians chapter number 6, verse number 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment, with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. Children, obey. What does it mean to obey? It means your actions, you listen and you obey right away. I learned a lot of things from my father-in-law. But one of the most valuable things that I ever learned was when Cameron and Caleb were very, very, very little. Just learn how to walk. I think Cameron learned how to walk. Caleb was learning how to walk. And maybe some of you have done this because I had never seen parents growing up. My mom and dad were divorced, and you know, they were best friends, but divorced. And I had never been around kids growing up, so I just did what I saw. So Cameron was doing something. I said, Cameron, come here. And she just looked at me, kind of like she does now. I said, Cameron, come here. One, two, two and a half, two and three quarters, two and seven eighths. And finally, when you're about to say three, they know when you say they start to come towards you, right? Later on that day, my father-in-law said, hey, let's go out to coffee. So we got the coffee. He says, I don't want to step on your parenting skills. He goes, but do you mind if I share something with you that might change your life? I said, yeah. He said, you know, every time you say, Cameron, come here, or Caleb, come here, and you start to count, you know what you're doing? I said, no, what am I doing? He says, you're teaching them to delay in their obedience. Man, I tell you what, he could have knocked me over with a feather. I almost fell down right there in a Dunkin' Donuts floor and started crying out to God, forgive me. But you know what? That one piece of advice literally changed my life. I came back that next night. Cameron come here, and she was waiting for the one. And I said, come here. And she looked at me. I said, okay, we're going for a walk. What happened? Delayed obedience. Children, obey your parents. How many of us want our kids to obey if they're still in the house? Sometimes when not in the house, we still want them to obey. Amen? I'll tell you what. Parents, are you obeying what God tells you? Mic drop. Monkey see, monkey do. Right? When we watch our kids, maybe our kids will watch us. When we instruct our kids, maybe we listen to God's instruction and we obey. Guess what he begins to do with us? He begins to bring us blessings. What is honor? Honor equals your attitude. So obedience is your actions. Honor is your attitude. Caleb, I want you to go do the dishes. He was obedient, but the actions didn't match up. Amen? How many times have us like that? Yes? God wants us to do something. I don't know if I should do it. No. God wants us to do it. And finally, number 11, fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. What does it mean to provoke? It means to continually, purposely irritate, make them bitter, cause someone to react because of your actions. So, how do we close? If your home is not a godly biblical home, if there's any part of the message that spoke to you as the piano player plays, we should all be here saying, God, forgive me and help me be better so I can have a godly home. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, he wants you to have a heavenly home. So how do I get that heavenly home? All you have to do is pray and ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. You pray like this. Dear Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. I now ask you to be my Lord and Savior. Help me to die on the cross. Help me to understand how you died on the cross, and now I believe it. Forgive me for my sins, and I now give you my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you're here today, say, Pastor Casey, I just prayed, and I just asked Jesus to be my Savior. Praise God, you now have a heavenly home. If you're here today, say, Pastor, I'm not sure that I have a church home, but I want this to be my church home, or I like this place, then maybe as the music plays, you come down to the old-fashioned altar and say, I want to pray about my church home. But if you're like me, maybe you say, Lord, I want to have more of a godly home. I want to take this time, and I want to pray that I can have more of a godly home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The altar's open. Thank you. Gracious Father, we thank you so much for your word that never changes. I pray, God, you bless this fellowship time we're about to have in the fellowship hall. I pray, God, you bless the teens tonight as they come back at 6 o'clock, hang out, have some food, some fun, some fellowship in your word. God, I pray that you continue to bless Adams Square Baptist Church, Freedom Christian Academy. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've done so far, and we just want to praise you for your goodness and your love. Lord, I pray that you restore families. I pray that men would step up and be the men that they need to be. I pray, Lord, that you would help encourage the ladies, perhaps going through a tough time right now. God, I pray the children would listen and obey their parents, realize their parents aren't perfect, but have a desire to walk towards you. Lord, help fathers to be more godly and holy and more righteous. Thank you for mothers. Lord, thank you that our lives are not built upon our good works, but are built upon the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ. Thank you for the saving knowledge of Christ. Thank you for the free gift of salvation. Lord, bless our day. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This is what the Freedom Christian Academy sweatshirts look like on the back. You can grab one. We got adult sizes and youth sizes, and then here's what it looks like on the front. $35 for youth, $45 for the adults. Tyron?
Last hymn is 482, please, Dwelling in Beulah Land, 482. Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the sins of earth beset on every hand. Doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath a cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah Land. Let the stormy breezes blow, their cry cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered, too protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining, here this naught can harm me. I am safe forever in Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath a cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah Land. Viewing here the works of God, I sink in contemplation. Hearing now his blessed voice, I see the way he planned. Dwelling in the Spirit here, I learn a full salvation. Gladly will I tarry in Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath a cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah Land.
Amen. Have a blessed day, church.
All right, everybody, don't forget, we still have Vacation Bible School sign up in the back at a computer, so right back here in the atrium. and donation boomerangs.